JavaScript is like Binod. It's everywhere. I'm just kidding, but you know, JavaScript can run inside a browser. It can run inside a server. It can run inside your smartwatch. It can run inside a light bulb. It can even run inside robots, isn't it? And you know, how is all that possible? It's all possible because of the JavaScript runtime environment. Yes. JavaScript runtime environment is like a big container which has all the things required to run JavaScript code. Can you guess what can be these things? Yes, you are absolutely right. To run any piece of JavaScript code, you definitely will need a JavaScript engine, isn't it? So it has a JS engine. Can you guess what else could be here? Let me tell you. So it can also have a set of APIs to connect to the outer environment, isn't it? We can also have an event loop inside JavaScript runtime environment. We can also have a callback queue. We can also have a microtask queue. So we can have a lot of things inside the JavaScript runtime environment. But this is basically a container which has all the things you need to execute your JavaScript code. And let me tell you, my friends, JavaScript runtime environment is not possible without the JavaScript engine. So basically, JavaScript engine is the heart of this JavaScript runtime environment. Okay. If you have watched my previous event loop video, then you might have already got an idea about what am I talking about. Yes, I'm talking about the browser. So browser can only execute your JavaScript code just because it has the JavaScript runtime environment. Every browser has this JavaScript runtime environment. You must have definitely heard of the famous Node.js, right? So Node.js also has a JavaScript runtime environment. So if you Google Node.js, you will find out that it is a open source JavaScript runtime. That means it has everything which is required to run JavaScript piece of code. And Node.js can run this JavaScript piece of code outside the browser. And suppose if we want to run some JavaScript piece of code in our water cooler, what do we need? All you need is the JavaScript runtime environment. This you will need inside your water cooler. Okay. It can have a JavaScript engine, and these APIs could be different inside the water cooler. It can have an API get water level, okay, which you can use it in your JavaScript code through a global object, and there could be an API get water level, okay, which gets the water level from the water cooler. Okay, that is why JavaScript is capable of running in a lot of devices, just because of this JavaScript runtime environment. And these set of APIs gives access to the superpowers which we can use inside our JavaScript code. Okay, and it is different in case of browser, it is different in case of Node, and sometimes it is common also. For example, the JavaScript runtime environment inside the browser has an API known as local storage that gives us superpower of accessing local storage from our code, right? And in case of Node.js, it could be different. And there are few APIs which have same name and which are present inside the browser as well as Node.js. For example, the set timeout. Right? So the set timeout is API is present inside the runtime environment of the browser as well as the Node.js. And the same is the case with console. You do the console.log, right? So it is the API, console is the API which is present inside the runtime environment of the browser as well as Node. And there could be different APIs for browser as well as Node. So these APIs name look very same, right? Set timeout in browser looks very exactly similar to the Node.js one, right? But internally they are implemented very differently inside, right? So the set timeout of browser might have a different implementation than the set timeout of Node. And similarly, you can find all sort of APIs in all sort of JavaScript runtime environments. And that is what makes JavaScript very beautiful, isn't it? You can access that outer environment through these set of APIs, and you can run a JavaScript piece of code inside this JavaScript runtime environment. It's beautiful, isn't it? Now we already know that JavaScript engine is the heart of this JavaScript runtime environment. Let us now dive deep inside this module JavaScript engine and see what happens inside this. There is a lot of awesome things happening. Let's just see. And you will definitely fall in love with JavaScript a little more. Okay. Before moving on to the architecture of JavaScript engine, let me show you the list of JavaScript engines available. So on Wikipedia, you can find out that there are a lot of JavaScript engines available. All browsers have their own JavaScript engine. So Microsoft Edge has a JavaScript engine, which is known as Chakra. Okay. And the browser Mozilla Firefox has a JavaScript engine, which is known as SpiderMonkey. Nice name, right? The SpiderMonkey. And similarly, Google Chrome has the JS engine, which is very famous. It's known as V8. You might have definitely heard of V8, right? So it's the same JavaScript engine which is used inside Google Chrome, even in the Node.js, even in Dino, right? So these are basically list of a lot of JavaScript engines. And you know what? You can create your own JavaScript engine as well. The most important protocol for a JavaScript engine is that following the standards. So there are ECMAScript standards, ECMAScript language standards, which needs to be followed by these engines. Okay, and ECMAScript, right? So ECMAScript is kind of like a governing body of the JavaScript, the language. Okay, I would highly recommend you to Google ECMAScript and read more about it. But for now, let's move on to the very interesting question. Okay, which is, what was the first JavaScript engine developed in the world? What was it? Can you guess? Let me tell you. So the first JavaScript engine was developed by the creator of JavaScript himself. Okay, he was Brendan Eich. He created JavaScript and he also created a JavaScript engine when he was working in Netscape. That engine has now evolved a lot and now it is known as SpiderMonkey, which is used inside the Mozilla Firefox browser. This one. Okay, so that was the first JavaScript engine which was ever created. Now let's move on to the JavaScript engine architecture. Let us now see what this JavaScript engine actually looks like and what is there inside it. Why is there so much hype about it? Let's see now. Before I move ahead, I want to clarify an important thing. So JavaScript engine is not a machine. Many new developers who are coming in like gets confused about this thing, right? They think of engine as something as a hardware which is running your code. Okay, it's like some hardware which is taking your code and executing something, nothing like that. So JavaScript engine is nothing but just like a normal program, okay, like a normal code which is written in low level languages. For example, Google's V8 engine is written inside C++. Okay, that's again a piece of code which is written by engineers just like you and me. Okay, nothing special about it. So that piece of code or the JavaScript engine takes in a code which is high level code what we write inside JavaScript and kind of spits out the machine level code which can be executed by the machine. So that's all it does. It's like a normal program. But to make things more clear, that is why we kind of like represent it using a box or a diagram or something like that. But in general, it is just like a normal code. Okay. So now let's move on to the JavaScript engine architecture. We'll see what happens actually inside the JavaScript engine. Okay. So JavaScript engine basically takes code as the input, the human readable code, what we write in JavaScript, it basically takes that code. Okay. And this code now goes through three major steps. Okay. Those three major steps include, the first step is parsing. Okay. The second step after parsing is the compilation. Okay. And the third step is execution. These are the three major things happening with your code inside the JavaScript engine. Let's see each one of them one by one and see how beautifully it executes the code. Okay. So let's see the first step first. During this parsing phase, the code which you write is broken down into tokens. Okay. So suppose if you write a piece of code which is let a is equals to 7, so this code is broken down into tokens. So let is one token, a is another token, equal to is another token, so something like this. And there is also something known as syntax parser. So the job of the syntax parser is to basically take the code and basically convert it into an AST. Now you must be thinking about what is this AST. So AST basically is known as abstract syntax tree. It sounds complicated, right? But it is not. Let me just write it down. I'll show you. So this abstract syntax tree sounds very complicated, isn't it? But trust me, it is not. I'll show you how this abstract syntax tree looks like. So the abstract syntax tree looks something like this. Okay, this is an abstract syntax tree for this piece of code. So suppose if we write the JavaScript line, const best course is equals to namaste JavaScript. So it generates the syntax parser, right? Over here, the syntax parser generates this AST, and that AST looks something like this. Okay, so this is basically const best course is equals to namaste JavaScript. This is basically the head of the tree, and then you have the declarations inside it. So this declaration is kind of have a name, which is best course, this name, and a value, which is namaste JavaScript, which is this. So it basically kind of generates this kind of a whole big tree structure. So you don't have to like mess up your head around this structure. I'm just showing you out of curiosity, but it kind of your parsing stage takes that piece of code and generates this kind of an abstract syntax tree. And my friend, this is just the syntax tree for just one line of code. Think about thousands of lines of code, what this tree would look like. So this is this abstract syntax tree, which is generated after the parsing level. That means now the AST, which is generated, is then passed on to the compilation phase. Okay. And yes, note down this beautiful website, astexplorer.net. Okay. This is a beautiful website, which I found out, which basically kind of generates an AST and shows how the AST looks for a piece of JavaScript code. Do check it out and try it out. It is like super fun. I just found this website. Okay, so now let's get back to the compilation stage. So this compilation and execution stage is my favorite. Okay, it's the best part of the execution of whole JavaScript code. Let's see how it works. And the compilation and execution goes hand in hand. Okay, so we will see all this. Let me just delete things before I move on to the compilation and execution stage. Now listen to me very carefully. We are moving on to a very important concept. Okay, so JavaScript has something known as just-in-time compilation. Okay, so before we understand what is just-in-time compilation, first of all, let us understand what is an interpreter, what is a compiler, and like, is JavaScript interpreted language or a compiled language? This is a very interesting and intriguing question. Okay, let's see what it is. So first, let's see what's an interpreter. In many interpreted programming languages, the code is executed using an interpreter. So this interpreter basically takes your code and it starts executing the code line by line in the order. It does not know what will happen in the next line. So that's how the whole code is executed. While on the other hand, there are many languages which uses a compiler to compile their code. Okay. So in case of a compiler, your whole code is compiled first of all, even before executing. Okay. So this code is compiled and a new code is formed, which is the optimized version of this code. Okay. This is the optimized version of this code and then it is executed. So first of all, your original code is modified and then the new code is the optimized version of the code, which runs very fast and it has a lot of performance improvements. So that's how the compiled languages work. So there are pros and cons in both interpreter as well as compiler. Okay, so in an interpreter, the code is fast, right? It is fastly executed and it does not have to wait for the code to be compiled first, and it can like immediately starts executing line by line, right? So in case of compiler, we have more efficiency. Okay, but in case of interpreter, we have more speed. Okay, the code runs fast. So now can you guess JavaScript is an interpreted language or a compiled language? Nice question, right? So JavaScript can behave like an interpreted language as well as compiled language. Everything is dependent on the JavaScript engine. Okay. So when JavaScript was initially created by Brendan Eich, it was supposed to be an interpreted language. Okay. The JavaScript engine, which he wrote, uses an interpreter to execute the code. Okay. Because it used to majorly run on browsers and browsers can't wait for that code to compile before running or executing everything. So it was an interpreter language. But now in today's world, most of the modern browsers you see and most of the modern JS engines uses an interpreter plus a compiler both together. So now it all depends on the JS engine, whether it is purely interpreted or it is just in time compiled. So there is an interesting term, a jargon again, which is just in time compilation, which comes from this only, that JavaScript engines can use an interpreter along with a compiler, and that makes it as a just in time compiled language. So JIT compilation is like the best of the both worlds. It uses both interpreter plus a compiler to execute the code. It's very interesting. So let's now just dive deep and see more inside how things are working, okay? So now this compilation as well as execution go hand in hand, okay? So after parsing, we got this AST, right? So this AST is then goes to the interpreter. So now this interpreter converts our high level code to bytecode, and that code moves to the execution step. And while it is doing so, it takes the help of the compiler to optimize the code. So compiler basically talks to the interpreter, and while the code is being interpreted line by line, the compiler also basically tries to optimize the code as much as it can. So it is not just one phase process, but it can happen in multiple phases. All these JavaScript engines have their own algorithms of doing it. So the job of compiler over here is to optimize the code as much as it can on the runtime. That is why it is also known as just-in-time compilation. Okay. In some JavaScript engines, there is something known as AOT, ahead of time compilation. Okay. In that case, the compiler basically takes a piece of code which is going to be executed later and tries to optimize it as much as it can. And it also produces the bytecode, which is then goes to the execution phase. And this execution over here is not possible without two major components of the JavaScript engine. Those two components are the memory heap and the call stack. Remember the call stack? Do you remember it? The call stack which we talked about a lot in this course. Do you remember that call stack? Yes, it is the same. Wait. Let me show you what it is. Yes? Remember? Let me go back. So this whole JavaScript runtime had a JavaScript engine, and inside JavaScript engine we had a call stack, right? In which we have all these execution contexts which are coming in and popping out, right? The functions are executed. That's what the call stack is present over here inside this JavaScript engine. Now can you imagine the bigger picture? JavaScript runtime, and then inside it is a JavaScript engine, and inside JavaScript engine there are so many phases: parsing, compilation, interpreter, compiler, execution, and we also have memory heap plus the call stack. These are all the things which are present inside JS engine. That is what makes JavaScript very beautiful when we see how it is executed behind the scenes, right? So this call stack is basically exactly what we used to see inside the previous lectures. Okay. So this is what call stack is. And now here we also have memory heap. So this is the place where all the memory is stored. Okay. So it is constantly in sync with the call stack, the garbage collector, and a lot of other things. Those pieces and everything works together, right? So memory heap is the space where all the variables and functions are assigned memory, okay? All this is amazing, right? Let me tell you more amazing things. So now we also have garbage collector into the picture. So we also have a garbage collector. It basically tries to free up memory space whenever possible. Whenever some function is not being used, or we clear the timeout, so it basically like collects all the garbage and like sweeps it. So it uses an algorithm which is known as mark and sweep algorithm. Go and read about it, okay? Mark and sweep algorithm, okay? So this time I'm giving you homework, okay? So I'm giving you homework. So this is your homework, note it down. So you have to do this study. I'm not going diving deep into these small things. otherwise this video is going to be very long. But remember this thing, you have to go and read about mark and sweep algorithm. This mark and sweep algorithm is like very important, and it is widely used across the garbage collectors out there, not just for the JavaScript only, but widely used. There are many other forms of optimizations which a compiler does for the code. And those optimizations are like inlining, copy elision, inline caching, and a lot of other things which this compiler is doing while it is compiling the code. Okay? Let me just write it down so that you can go ahead and read it. These things are like very beautiful when you read internal behind the scenes of these algorithms. Okay? So there is something known as inlining, okay, and there is something known as copy elision, and along with this we also have inline caching. I know it is too much in a single video, but these things are so interesting that I could not make it shorter than this. Okay, I am telling you honestly. The whole process which I explained to you inside this JS engine is very generic. All the JavaScript engine have their own ways of implementing things, okay? But most of the modern JavaScript browsers have something similar to this, okay? So this abstract syntax tree is present in like almost all the JavaScript engines, and there is an interpreter, there is a compiler, and there are a lot of other optimization tricks which each JavaScript engine implements on their own. Okay, so maybe the compilation logic inside the Google's V8 engine is very different from the SpiderMonkey which is inside the Firefox. Okay, and this is what each company is trying to achieve. They want to make their JavaScript engine as fast as possible. There are engineers who are working day and night to make these optimizations as better as possible so that they can save your microseconds. Okay. And that is why there is so much competition. Every browser wants to make their JavaScript engine the best in the world. But right now, at this present time, Google's V8 engine is considered to be the fastest among the all JavaScript engines ever created. And you know, I personally love to read their V8 blog. It is so interesting and it is like very knowledge heavy. When we are talking about V8, let me tell you interesting things about V8. So V8 has a interpreter which is known as Ignition. Nice name, right? I really love the name which Google gives. Okay, so we have a Ignition interpreter over here inside the V8, and along with that we have Turbofan. Okay, Turbofan is the optimizing compiler, what they call it as. So they have Turbofan optimizing compiler which basically does this job of compiling the code very fast. So the Ignition interpreter along with this Turbofan optimizing compiler, they both make your code run very fast. So now when we are talking so much, then just give me 2 minutes. I'll quickly show you the V8 JavaScript engine architecture. Okay, so here we are with the V8 JavaScript engine architecture. So just like I showed you in this architectural diagram, right, the generic one, it is same inside the V8 engine. So JavaScript source code goes through a parser, the syntax parser which I told you, and it generates an abstract syntax tree, right? And then this abstract syntax tree has in this Ignition interpreter, right? This interpreter Ignition, right? And it converts the code to the bytecode, which is then executed. Okay, this code is executed, and along with the interpreter works the Turbofan compiler, just like I showed you, right? This compiler, it is the Turbofan compiler over here in V8, right? And this Turbofan compiler is constantly working on optimizing the code, and it produces this optimized code and like generates this bytecode which is then later executed. So this is how the V8 engine looks like from inside, and like it is awesome. I'll definitely suggest you to go ahead and read from the official V8 website. They have beautiful articles of everything what I just told you, like everything is present on their blogs. And not just this, they also have a garbage collector which is known as Orinoco. Okay, so go read about it. It uses the mark and sweep algorithm which I told you. Read about that mark and sweep algorithm. They also have a garbage collector known as Oil Pan. which is used for a different purpose. Go read all these terms, find out, Google it, and you will like love the whole process. So before we end this, just let us quickly revise everything. It was very interesting, right? Let us just quickly revise it so that it stays into your memory forever, okay? So we have this JavaScript runtime environment. So whenever you execute any JavaScript piece of code, it needs a container which has everything required to run in JavaScript code. That was the JavaScript runtime environment. The browser has a runtime environment. Node.js has a JavaScript runtime environment, okay? And it constitutes of the heart of the JavaScript runtime environment, which is the JavaScript engine. It also has access to APIs, callback queues, event loop, and a lot of other stuff. It depends on the JavaScript runtime environment. There could be different things inside different JavaScript runtime environments, okay? This was the first thing. Now let us dive deep inside the JS engine, okay? So JS engine had many phases, right? They had three phases. The code was first went through the parsing phase, the compilation phase, then the execution phase. In the parsing phase, tokens are generated, and after the tokens, the syntax parser basically parses the whole code and then converts it into an AST, right? That tree. So this is that AST, that whole big tree, right? Now this AST then passed on to the interpreter. So JavaScript is a just-in-time compiled language. Remember that, okay? Most of the modern browsers have this kind of interpreter plus compiler inside them to make this code optimized more and more and runs it very fast. Okay, so we have an interpreter, we have a compiler, and the abstract syntax tree then goes to the interpreter. Interpreter produces the bytecode, which is then being executed with the help of memory heap and the call stack. And this compiler is like constantly working upon optimizing the code as much as possible. We have a garbage collector, which basically does its jobs of collecting garbage and optimize the memory space which is used by the JavaScript engine, okay? And we also have a lot of other optimization techniques. Go and read about all of them: inlining, copy elision, inline caching. These are the most important ones. Go read out them. So that's all in the JavaScript engine. And now tell me, my friends, do you love JavaScript or not? Tell me in the comments that do you love JavaScript or not now? I took the mission to make you fall in love with JavaScript. Tell me in the comments, do you love JavaScript or not? I want to hear from you. JavaScript is like so beautiful, okay? If you're still not falling in love with JavaScript, let me tell you an interesting thing. So there are few languages which are procedural programming languages. There are few languages which are functional programming languages. There are few languages which are object-oriented programming languages. But JavaScript, my friend, is so beautiful that you can use it for any of these paradigms. You can do functional programming in JavaScript as well as object-oriented programming in JavaScript. In the next video, we will be touching a little bit of functional programming and higher order functions. You will definitely love it. But before moving on to that video, comment down and let me know whether you have started falling in love with JavaScript or not. Comment down. I want to know your answer. And even if you don't comment on any video, do comment down in this video. I want to know. The mission of this course is to make you fall in love with JavaScript, and I will definitely do it. That's all in this video, my friends. And thank you for watching. Namaste JavaScript.